Mr. Commissioner Kara, potential leader of the Western and the Western regions, chairman of the Indirect Taxes Committee, the chairman of the TT Sharma, very regular representative of the RRC in this seminar for some years. And of course, a very, very learned speaker, a dear friend, Gautam Nayak. And of course, Colonel MB, the Arvind Kajal, is on the audience. We're just wondering that how the speakers would be able to deal with the number of amendments which have been made. But let me just report when the finance minister started his speech. When he initially started his speech, I think if there are 19, he laid down the 10 distinct themes. The first theme was farmer, and the 10th was, for the first time I show in the history, referring tax administration as the theme of a budget. So number 10 is tax administration, and that dash to honor honest taxpayers. But somehow, very curiously, I was waiting to end, that when he reaches the last head of tax administration, what is he going to speak? But he spoke on 4, 1 to 9, and perhaps he did not speak a word on item number 10. That's what I was searching in this book, as he is written on the perhaps. So that shows perhaps he also finds it difficult to deal with the tax administration. I hope that you get a grip over the tax administration of this country. And if you get a grip over the tax administration of the country, you don't have to change law. Law could be complex. If the tax administration is failed, by and large, the common taxpayers will not feel a pinch of it. But somehow, what we have been doing is exactly reverse. We are not doing anything with regard to a tax administration, and we have been complicating the law year after year. So, Mansiva, I think, mentioned that there are 186 amendments in this budget. When he finished this speech, he never realized that there will be 186 amendments in this budget. Of course, the speakers who deal with the nitty-gritties, let me just make reference to one or two. The amendment which is made in 56-7, which we, 56-2, subclause 10, which is sought to be introduced, which effectively, as we usually qualify, as deal with the gifts. It is in 1998, if my memory goes correct, when I spoke on the same platform on that subject, when the Gift Tax Act was abolished. And immediately in the next budget, it was the Mr. Yashwant Sinha's budget, 56-2, some clause was sought to be introduced of the type which we are talking today. It was so widely worded that anything under the sun could have come in this 56-2 at that time. So there was a UN cry, and I still remember that BJP professional says had called a meeting at the instance of Sakir Somaya, who brought Yashwant Sinha there to meet those professionals. So some of us were there, myself and Narayan Verma, both of us were there, and I think two representatives from Chamber also were there. So we are four persons, and we were told at that time that you have 2 minutes to speak, and we are four persons. So internally we were thinking what to say in 2 minutes. I think they said 1 minute, not even 2 minutes. So internally we decided that Mr. Verma, being the senior of all four, we'll go and present him a flower, and we'll tell him that after this budget is passed, if I give you this flower, it will become your income from other sources. So widely it was worded, and that was reported in a very small column by Times of India, I still recall. And fortunately, I think that stuck to him at that time. I don't know whether that was the reason, but that proposal was withdrawn at the final stage. So, since then, till 2004, nobody was up. It is Mr. Chidambaram again in 2004 thought of bringing back this provision. At that time, the object was only to take care of what they call it as unaccounted money. At the bill said, if you recall, I have seen from my memory, 56-5, which was sought to be introduced, it used the word sum. And there was a UN cry that sum would include, in addition to money, all other kinds of gifts also. And the intention of Mr. Chidambaram was only to cover money. So at the next day, that sum was verified to sum of money. So that's how that sum of money word came. Then of course in 2009, further extension, and now we have almost everything again is getting covered, not of course of the type which was proposed in 1988, fortunately. So that's the wide scope of this 56-10. Another is, I think, amendments relating to charity. I think it is the charity which gets the most uncharitable treatment year after year, you know, in this country under the Income Tax Act. I don't have time to take you through what Mr. Bhagyavala has observed on this is old edition, but this is one particular set of provisions which is considered to be dealing with charity, the most complex set of provisions. There are two amendments proposed in the charity, and the effect thereof, of course, I think Gautam will explain to us. Very dangerous amendments are, you know, proposed here. There are a large number of other amendments which have been proposed, which the speakers will deal with. But I'm also concerned about the tax deduction at source by an individual who is not covered by 44AB. Now, to what extent do you want to expand the scope of EDS? I remember, I think for the first time, I was asked at the Ahmedabad One India Conference of the Institute by Ramubhai Patel in those days, somewhere in the late 90s, to write a paper on TDS as somebody's substitute. I was mentioned there also. And after writing that paper, I decided in life that I will not practice in TDS. And since then, I have not been practicing on TDS, though for the purpose of academic TDS that you were looking at. Primarily, I always believe that tax collection is the responsibility of the government. People by a statute of law have been asked to collect tax on their behalf. So, really speaking, we have been rendering services to the government free of charge, for which effectively we should be paid some commission. But instead of that, what we are getting is, I don't think I have to explain to you that this is how the TDS provisions are implemented. Somehow, every year, this net keeps on getting wider. One day it will come there, there will not be any need to have an advance sale. Everything will be under the TDS provisions, so the department has not to do anything. So, these are the types of amendments which are coming. And again, this NDA government, this second term, if I would call it, is from 2014. Even in the last 3 years, I have been observing that gradually, more and more powers are getting vested in the department. The powers are becoming wide and wide. Look at in this budget itself, you are now extending the scope of survey to a charity. Is it meant for either getting the admission somewhere, or it is meant for getting admission in the hospital? I do not know. I have never contemplated in my life. There will be one day 133A will be amended to include charity therein, because that is where they want to survey. So unfortunate part is, though it's becoming indiscriminately complex, harsh, with very wide powers to the departments. And fortunately, you know, I have started retiring now from the practice, so I will not have to face that music. But I always wonder that the young professionals who have been coming in the profession, what is going to be the flight thereof? I am sure that Gautam will explain to us the clauses which have been allocated to him, and I am sure that then you will have a number of takeaways for the benefit of the practice and clarity with regard to the proposals which have been made in this finance year 2017. May I request Gautam to make his presentation on the process allocated to him.
Trustee Chairman, President of the Council members,
I must appreciate and sincerely thank for Gautam having come today, in spite of his wife being not well, so that he meets the commitment. We must thank him for this.
Chairman of committee Kishor Majani and dear friends. Well, I think Kishor may mention that I will deal with all the clauses that I wanted to deal. Let me just clarify that out of the 180 plus clauses, the amendments, probably I will have to deal with 120 plus amendments. And the time which I have left 15 is 140 amendments, or maybe 1 hour. So in 1 hour I have to deal with 120 amendments. I have half a minute to deal with each amendment. So I think practically I think it's something which is impossible given the large number of amendments that we have this time. In fact, what I will try to do is try and cover up all the major amendments. I think most of the other major amendments are being dealt with by Yogesh. So let's look at the backdrop in which this direct taxes are made of budget. The budget in relation to direct taxes was was that we had demonetization, we had the threat of more to come, we had all sorts of. So there was a large expectation that there would be some wide ranging reform which would be carried out this time in this budget. To that extent, I think this the direct tax proposals have been a bit of a significant letdown. In a sense, it's been the same routine sort of. There have been one or two changes which have been in relation to cash, etc. Otherwise, I think when you look at it, this time it's been budget as usual. In fact, I would say worse than usual because given the large number of amendments, small tinkering which has gone into this budget this time. And, the feeling was that given the large amount of collections which the government has got from the income stimulus scheme, from the PMGKY, demonetization, etc., there would be some significant giveaway. So, if you look at the giveaways, that's in the rates of tax area if you look at it. And as you know, the first lakh from 250,000 to 5 lakhs goes down from 10%, it goes down to 5%. So everybody benefits to that extent of, anybody who has income over 5 lakhs will benefit of 12,500 plus interest to that extent. But, as I say, whenever they give you something, they take away something. So what happened is, they said that earlier, because the rate was 10%, you get a rebate of 5,000 rupees. Which meant on 50,000 rupees, effectively you don't pay any tax. Now that the rate has come down to 5%, so they have reduced the rebate under Section 87A to 2,500 rupees. So that again, the benefit is only of an income of 50,000 rupees. So that's the way it has. There is, of course, when there's such a large giveaway, there has to be something taken back, and that take back is through the surcharge which has now come in for 10% for individuals in the slab of 50 lakhs to 1 crore. So there is a surcharge of 10%. There was no surcharge. The surcharge currently was only when the income above 1 crore, you have to pay a surcharge of 15%. So now you have a surcharge of 10% for the incomes from 50 lakhs to 1 crore. Below 50 lakhs, there is no surcharge. So in the slab between 50 lakhs to 1 crore, you have a rate of 33.99% effectively. And you of course have a marginal relief. Where your income exceeds 50 lakhs, to the extent that income exceeds the additional tax rate on that extra income over 50 lakhs, that fee. Last year, as you know, Finance Minister earlier announced that the rates of tax for corporates will come down to the year before last year, over a period of 3 years, the rates will come down to, by March 18, the rates will come down to 25%. Now 25% of course, as you know, is a misnomer because then you add on the litigation sales, you add on the surcharge, etc. So when you say 30%, 30% really means 35% today. That's the way as you know. Now last year a beginning was made in the sense one thought that there would be some reduction last year. Last year a small beginning was done by saying that for companies with a turnover of up to 5 crores during the financial year 2014-15, in assessment year 16-17, such companies will pay a tax, the tax rate would go down by 1%, they would pay 29% plus surcharge plus less. That was the concession which was given last year. And you also had a reduced rate of 25% for certain new companies which was introduced. That was this year the feeling was that general across the board there would be at least a 1% or 2% reduction as far as companies are concerned, so as to meet the target of coming down to 25% over a period of time. Unfortunately, this year also what has been done is they do say it covers a large number of companies, but most of these companies are small and medium companies. And what you have is a reduced rate of 25%, provided that the turnover does not exceed 50 crore. Which year's turnover you have to look at? You have to look at the turnover of the financial year 2015-16. That is the year which has already gone by, not 16-17. So when you are looking at, we are looking at assessment year 18-19 is the relevant year for taxation. Assessment year 18-19, which is the financial year 17-18, you don't look at the earlier year's turnover, you look at the turnover 2 years before. So that's the way they look at it. Well, I don't know what the significance of that is. Probably they feel that you've already filed a return for 2015-16 financial year. So therefore there's no scope for you to manipulate a turnover. If we give you a turnover of 16-17, there still is 2 months left for you to adjust your turnover so that you meet the criteria. Possibly that may be the reason. But that is all the problem. What would be the position of a company which is far formed after March 2016, since you have to take the turnover earlier of the earlier period? The question is, because it has no turnover at all, so the company was not in existence at all. So can the department say that this will not get the benefit? Well, the intention certainly seems to be give the benefit, because what you're doing is that a company which had was small or this, that's why you want to give the benefit. The CBD chairman, I think 3 or 4 days back in a news report has clarified that we will be coming out with a clarification on this in case of new companies, whether they will get the benefit of this reduced rate. So we'll have to wait and see. And that's one of the things which we're seeing more and more, that most of the, so many complications are being introduced, and many of these complications are being addressed only through clarifications which are brought about at, about issued by the CBDT, etc. That's the other aspect here is because this uses the language total turnover or gross receipts. Now, what is the meaning of total turnover or gross receipts? Would it include service tax, excise, VAT? Do you look at section 145A, which says that the value of sales would include taxes, etc.? We look at it from that perspective. I think what you should look at is look at the institute's guidance note on tax audit under section 44AB. In that, they have defined what is the meaning of turnover, etc. And to that extent, where, for instance, normally excise would form part of total turnover, but so far as VAT is concerned, it would not form part of total turnover. Similarly, service tax would not form part of the total turnover. Possibly that's the way we have to look at it. The next amendment which I will deal with is on the tax on dividends. As you know, last year, dividends was entirely exempt from tax in the hands of the recipient of the shareholder because the company was paying a dividend distribution tax on. Last year they introduced provision in the form of section 105 DPDA. Under this, the shareholder is also liable to pay tax of 10% on the dividend which he has earned during the year from a domestic company in excess of rupees 10 lakhs. So that applies to individual, it applies to HUF, and it applies to partnership firms. Now partnership firm, as you know, also includes an LLP. So it was to these three categories of entities that it applied. So there was a lot of there was a lot of debate going on. What about the private trusts? Say many promoters hold the shares in companies through private trusts, etc. Would it apply to private trusts? Then what about if you have a AOP or DOI? Obviously, AOP or DOI is not covered, it's quite a different entity, etc. So, there of course, one view so far as private trusts are concerned, I think the some senior counsel have been opining that status of a private trust is also that of individual, and therefore this 105 DBA would apply to them. But now an amendment has been made saying that this will apply to all persons, all resident entities. So any person who is a resident, it will apply. So irrespective, so there will not be any debate as to whether this is a individual or whether it's a partnership firm or whether AOB, BOI. So irrespective of that, this 10% tax is something which will have to be paid. Now, there are only two exemptions. And what are those exemptions? One is for domestic companies. And domestic companies don't have to pay tax on the dividend that they receive, because there would be, you know, again, a further distribution tax will be in turn distributed to their shareholders. They would of course get the benefit of that set off which is available under Section 115(o) if you know, they hold more than the prescribed percentage, that prescribed percentage. The other category which is exempt is trusts which are referred to in Section 10, which is C4, 5, 6 or 6A, or which are registered under Section 12(a). Now, here of course the question here is that when they say trusts which are referred to in 1023 C4, 5, 6 or 6A, does it mean that, you know, as you know, that 6 and 6A deal with educational institutions and medical institutions? So the question which arises is that would it apply to all such medical institutions or educational institutions, or do they necessarily have to be registered under Section 1023 6 or 6A in the all 4 or 5? 4 and 5 are, you know, charitable institutions of public renown, and 5 is religious institutions of public renown. So the question there is, do they have to be registered under this relevant clause of Section 1023 or would it apply to all such institutions? And there I think the view is that if you look at the language of 1023-6 or 6A, it says, and where it's a, you know, it says a medical institution who's carrying on the activity of medical use, etc., and which is registered, which is approved under Section 12. So therefore, I think it's very clear that what is required is only those which are approved under those sections would be eligible, would fall outside the purview of Section 115(b)(d)(a). Now, of course, this provision does not apply to non-resident entities or NRIs, etc. Individuals also do not apply to. So, what would get covered now would be AOPs or BOIs. Private trusts, as I said, one view was that they already are covered, so family trusts, ESOP trusts, etc. All these were, I mean, one view was that they really already were covered because the status was individual. The other interesting part is that, you know, you have one which has come into assessment here, the place of effective management has come into the concept where a company is regarded as a resident if the place of effective management is in India, it would be now regarded as a resident. Now, that there is no exclusion so far as a foreign company which has become the resident by virtue of birth. Now, that is something which I think, so if a foreign company is regarded as a resident by virtue of the place of effective management rules, they would also have to pay a tax so far as this 10% tax is something which would apply to it. Then, so far as there are certain categories of institutions now, for instance, which are registered as trusts. Say, for instance, you have mutual funds under Section 1023B, or venture capital funds under Section 1023FB, or alternative investment fund under 1023FA. Now, would these institutions also have to pay 10% tax on the dividend that they receive? I would feel that no, because that is a separate exemption which is available to them. So far as this is concerned, they would not have to pay this 10% tax. Their income would be exempt in their hands. Then coming to the next series of ordinances in relation to exempt incomes. So far as NRE interest is concerned, there is one amendment where there was a reference to the wrong clause of which contained a definition of non-resident, because as you know, the definition of non-resident is taken from FEMA. So there was a wrong reference to the wrong clause. It was referred to as clause W, so it's clause Q, so that can happen. And so far as national pension scheme is concerned, there are a couple of amendments there. As you know, last year we had an amendment coming in whereby in Section 10-12A, whereby withdrawal of 40% of the corpus on closure of the NPS account or on opting out of the NPS scheme was given an exemption. Now, this year, a further exemption has been granted, and you have Section 10-12B, which has been inserted, which allows exemption for partial withdrawal up to 25% of the contribution made by an employee. Now, if you look at this amendment, this applies only to an employee. It would not apply to persons who are not employees. Secondly, the exemption is limited to 25% of contribution made by the employee would not take into account the contribution of the employer or the acquisition to the income, acquisition to the corpus by way of income of the The other interesting thing here is, and you know, if you look at the NTS scheme and the, you know, the various provisions of the Income Tax Act, you have 86CD which grants you the benefit of the reduction, and you have 6 clauses under which the reduction is given to you, and you have Subsection 3 which says that amounts which are received on closure or on opting out of the scheme, or amounts received as pension from the annuity plan purchased on closing or opting out of the scheme, that is taxable. So what is taxable is under 86(3). And that tax, whatever is taxable is subject to the exemptions which are provided under 10(12A) and 10(12B). Now, but what is exempt? What is taxable? What is taxable is only the amounts which are withdrawn on closure or on opting out of the scheme. Now here, what about partial withdrawals? Where is the provision to tax a partial withdrawal? Now, normally what happens is when an employee has contributed and he takes back his, can you say that it is income in the normal scheme of things? No, it's not income in the normal scheme of things. And therefore this is something which seems to be an amendment which I don't know what are the reasons for this particular, the way it has come out. Because unless you have a provision under 86(3), tax such amount the first place, the partial withdrawal which you may mean by continuing as a subscriber of the scheme. So unless you have that, you will cannot, you know, grant an exemption. So first you have to tax it, then only you can grant the exemption. So that's something which I think seems to be a bit of a problem. The second amendment so far as the NTS is concerned is in the amount eligible for deduction as subscription to NTS. Now currently you have 3 provisions, as I said, under ATCCB under which you get this deduction. You have subsection 1, which says that for an employee, 10% of the salary. For a person who is not an employee, it is 10% of his gross total income. So far as, then the second category is under subsection 2, which says so far as the employee is concerned, contribution made by an employer up to 10% of salary will also be allowed as a deduction. And you have subsection 1A, which came in a couple of years back, which says that a further contribution of 50,000 which is made will be also be qualified, and this will be over and above the limit of 150,000 which is available under section 80C, except ADCC and all that together. So you get additional 50,000 rupees. So therefore, so far as employee is concerned, what does he get? He gets 10% of his own salary is contribution, 10% of the employer, what his employer contributes, plus 50,000. But so far as person who is not an employee is concerned, he will get only 10% of his own contribution, because obviously there is no employer in such a situation, and you get the 50,000. So therefore, what they said is we want to bring on par both the employees. So therefore, up to 20, so far as a person who is not an employee is concerned, up to 20% you can contribute, and that will be allowed as a reduction in computing this total. So that's so far as the NTS amendments are concerned. So far as long-term capital gains exemption on transfer of equity shares, which is subject to STT is concerned, we've had a lot of this in relation to transactions in penny stocks. As you know that this exemption, whenever you have any exemption under the law, there's always some misuse which happens. And I remember way back when I was studying for my CA, I used to wonder why so many film stars have poultry farms and hotels and all that. And you know, in those days we used to have these deductions under Chapter 6A for profits of poultry farms and profits of hotels, the top high qualities were there. So that's where you should see a lot of, because that was, that provided a scope for money laundering, frankly speaking, for converting your black money into white. That was, so whenever you have an exemption like this, so therefore 1038, you have an exemption for long term capital gains, where STT is paid on the sale transaction. Now, therefore, you always have some issues. And this, I think this was becoming quite rampant, that companies which are not at all well known, on this, they would make a private placement and or they would sell some part of the promoter's equity to a new shareholder. The placement or the sale would take place at a very nominal price of sometimes 50 paise, 1 rupee, etc. The share price over the next 1 or 2 years would go up from 1 rupee or 50 paise to go up to 100 rupees, 200 rupees or whatever, and then the share will be sold, and effectively cash flow exchange hands for in exchange for profit, which are the tax free profit. So that was something which was happening, and the income tax department, realizing this was happening, took this matter of SEBI. SEBI investigated some 600 companies, and out of that, I think they penalized a few companies, 25, 30 companies, they were able to find that there was. Because what can SEBI do? SEBI can only curb price manipulation. So SEBI found out that there was price manipulation happening in some of the scripts, and they banned the promoters as well as the companies from accessing the capital market for a certain number of years, etc. But the larger number of companies, SEBI was not able to find evidence of price manipulation. The burden of proof is quite severe in that sense. So therefore, what the income tax department realized that, and we can see quite a few tribunal judgments have been coming of late, which says that where the seller of the shares is able to prove evidence that he sold the shares on the stock market through a broker who is registered with SEBI, he has documents which are not sham documents, these are genuine documents, contract notes, etc. He has given delivery of shares from his demat account, etc. In such situations, you cannot deny the benefit of the long-term capital gains exemption unless you have evidence to the contrary. That was the review of the tribunal meeting. So therefore, to curb that, the government came out with this with an amendment in this budget. And what is the amendment? The amendment is that this exemption under 1038 would not be available if the shares are acquired on or after 1st October 2004 and STT has not been cleared on the acquisition. What is the relevance of this 1st October 2004? It's the date on which STT came into force. That's the relevance of that. So, if shares are acquired prior to 1st October 2004, then this denial of the exemption would not be applicable. It's only for shares acquired after 1st October 2004 and which have not been submitted to STT. Now, when is STT paid? STT paid is paid only when the purchase is on the market, on the stock market. So, which would mean that today, if you are claiming the exemption, once this amendment comes into force, if you are claiming this exemption for any shares which are sold on the stock exchange, the officer will ask you to prove that you acquired these shares in a transaction which was subjected to STT. So, which means you will need to produce your purchase contracts. So, that is a significant change which will affect everybody. I think a large number of people have not been maintaining these purchase contracts, etc. But now you need to produce those as evidence that you purchased it when you purchased after 2004, so first October 2004. You need to produce this evidence in the form of the purchase contract. That's the first thing. The second, of course, is what they said is that the government can notify certain exceptions. And if you look at extract memorandum, they say that IPO or FPO, that's initial public offering or follow-on public offering, or bonus or rights issued by listed company, acquisition by a non-resident in accordance with FDI policy, these are likely to be notified. That's what they said. But the problem really is this, that it's not going to cover anything and everything. Now, one is that preferential allotment by unlisted companies, or purchased by way of private sale, these are definitely likely to get when the sale takes place after 1st April 2017. Now, what about sale by promoters? Promoters obviously got the share by way of allotment of the initial shares. Now, when they sell the shares, suppose the shares were allotted after 1st October 2004, then they will also have a problem. What about ESOPs? So, an employee who subscribes to ESOPs, the shares under ESOP are allotted by the company on exercisable stock options. Now, there you would have a problem. Similarly, transactions by private equity funds or venture capital funds, typically what happens is most of these transactions are either by way of infusion of further funds in the company where the company directly allots shares, or by purchase of the shares from the promoter. These are all unlisted companies, so therefore the transaction is certainly not liable to STT at the time when the investment is made. So therefore that's going to be another problem which is there. Now, these are all genuine transactions, and they will be hit unless the government says that we will come out with this list of exceptions. But I doubt whether this list will be comprehensive enough given the past record of the government in But this is something I think which representation will have to be made, that these are the types of transactions which try and give as exhaustive a list as possible to ensure that these transactions do not fall foul of this and one does not end up paying capital gains tax on this. So that is so far as this is concerned. Then There are certain other the next set of amendment is the next amendment is in relation to SEZ amendments. As you know, there was this dispute which was going on as to whether it's an exemption provision, section 10A or 10AA, are these exemption provisions or are they deduction provisions? Because the heading is deduction, and earlier, but it's placed before the exemption provisions, so it's not placed in chapter 6A, etc. So there was some doubt over there. The question here was, we had recently in December 2016, as recently as that, Supreme Court in Yokohama, India's case held that the context is dictating that it's now a section which is a ruling for deduction. And but the state of deduction is by computing the gross total income of the eligible undertaking under Chapter 4 and not at the state of computation of total income under Chapter 6. So that was the view which the Supreme Court has taken. And that ruling has now been overruled by amendment, by insertion and expression. But of course, in the context, now you have the section 10AA, 10A units that are present in the device. So 10AA units, which is your SEZ units, is expression inserted for room and which says that for room or doubts. The deduction is to be allowed on total income of the SEC computed in accordance with the Act before giving effect to section 10AA. And the deduction shall not exceed such total income. So therefore, effectively, you will get the deduction only if there is a positive total income before this deduction. So that's the way that this amendment is there. So what would be the impact? Say for instance, you have a SEZ unit which has made profits, but you have losses in other units, which could be SEZ units, non-SEZ units, you have losses. Now what would happen is, you would have a computer total income after a set of all the losses. So which means that there may not be any income or the income will be much less which qualifies for the benefit of the deduction under section 10AA. So that's the impact which is going to be quite significant on many of these. The next series of amendments which I will deal with is related to charitable trust, which Kishor mentioned in his initial remarks. Today, as you know, that if a charitable trust receives a corpus donation, that corpus donation is exempt under section 11(1)(d). A view is there that it's a capital receipt, though not with 75 that we have a special provision on 11(1)(d) for exemption. But what about the trust which gives the, suppose one trust gives a donation, corpus donation to another trust, can the corpus donation which is given by the donor trust be qualified as an acquisition of income for charitable purposes and would it therefore qualify for the purposes of the exemption? And we had quite a few decisions on this, and we had the leading decision was that of the Gujarat High Court in Saradevi Sarawai Trust number 2, 1-2-2-6-98, where the Gujarat High Court had held that donation made to corpus of another trust would amount to acquisition of income for charitable or religious purposes. So, therefore, the trust which gives the donation, corpus donation, treats it as an acquisition of income and therefore gets the benefit of the exemption. The trust which receives it for it, it is an exempt income. Because it's a corpus donation. Now, what we have, the law has now been amended, and corpus donations which are made to other trusts which are registered under section 12A would now not be treated as an acquisition of income for objects. So, that is so far as a trust which is registered under 12A is concerned. If it gives a corpus donation to another trust which is registered under section 12A, then a donation which is made would not be treated as an acquisition of income for charitable or religious purposes. Now, this is, you know, of course, there had been manipulation whereby certain trusts, you know, in order to ensure that they meet the spending obligation, do this. But there could be genuine corpus donations which are made to the corpus of other trusts. Say, for instance, today, one trust wants to support the activity of another trust where putting up a large building or a large project. So for capital purposes, it meets the cost of that capital expenditure. Now this will no longer qualify as an application for charitable or religious purpose. Now there are trusts which act as funding agencies. So they raise donations from the public and then they distribute it to deserving trusts for deserving projects. Now this would also now, because what is a corporate donation? Any capital donation is a corporate donation. So any donation which is meant to form part of the capital, so if it is for a capital purpose, say for instance it gives it for the setting up of a school, which we use for setting up a school, that's for campus purpose, and that's a proper tradition, and therefore it will not qualify as a business. Now that is something which is, I think, going to hit a large number of trust pretty badly, and that's something that. Now one interesting thing, there's a similar amendment made under Section 1023C in relation to trusts which are approved under 1023C 4, 5, 6 and 6A. So there, again, you have a similar amendment which says that if a donation is made to a trust registered under Section 12, then it will not be treated as an active joint for the office of that institution. Now, some of the 1023C trusts gives a donation, say for instance, to a trust which is registered under 1023C to another school, for instance, which is registered under 1023C. That will qualify as an additional income. Or if a trust which is registered under Section 12AA gives a donation to a trust which is approved under 1023C, say which is a hospital or to a school. Now, in that case also, that will qualify for the benefit of the exemption. This will be treated as so this amendment will not affect those trusts. Because so donation to a 1023C trust is not affected. It is only donation to a trust which is registered in Section 12AA. That is something which is affected. Now, here of course, when they refer to a trust registered in Section 12AA, it brings to mind the controversy which was there a couple of years back, where there was a reference, and when 12AA's we came in, for cancellation of registration of a trust, it referred to only where a trust is registered under Section 12AA. And at that point of time, tribunals had taken the view that this would not affect trusts which are registered under 12A. Earlier the registration was under 12A. Subsequently, 12AA came. So, trusts which are registered under 12A would not be affected. That was the view which the tribunals had taken. I think this is something which, again, this controversy will arise. If a trust is registered under 12A and not under 12AA, whether the parent, you know, one can say that this will amount to the acquisition of income is something which again will give us. The second exemption, the second amendment relationship challenges is where a trust undergoes a modification of its objects. As you know, last year we had this horrendous provision which has come in the section 115 PD. Now which said that under certain circumstances, a trust would be deemed to have converted itself into a trust for non-charitable purposes, and the fair market value of its assets less its liability would be taxed as an accredited income. Now that was the provision which has come in the last year. Now there, one of the things was that if a trust modifies its objects, which is not in conformity with the conditions of registration, and it seeks fresh registration under 12AA, or which is not granted, or it does not seek fresh registration at 12AA within the period of 30 days, then it will have to be taxed for accredited income. Now this went on the footing that if you modify your objects, you will have to seek fresh registration under Section 12AA. Now there are two or three things over here. One is that Section 12AA did not have any provision to say that if you modify your objects, you have to seek fresh registration under 12AA. Now, in recent years, I think over the last 8 to 10 years, trust which have been registered over the last 8 to 10 years, when the 12AA registration certificate was granted, one of the clauses has been that you will seek prior approval of the commissioner for any modification of the objects. There had been an Allahabad High Court decision which had taken the view that your objects itself is the basis on which your registration in 12A has been granted. If you do not take approval of the commissioner or inform the commissioner about the search, then you are not entitled to the benefit of exemption thenceforward. So that was the view the department took. Tribunals had then read down that decision, and the tribunals had been taken on review. But you know, the fact is remains that there was no provision under 12A for seeking fresh registration when you modify your objects, if you have not taken the prior approval of the commission. Now the amendment has come in, which says that if there is modification of objects which is not conforming to the initial registration, an actual registration has to be made within 30 days from the date of adoption or modification to the commissioner you make the admission, and the registration has been granted, it's only then that we get the benefit of exemption. Now what is the meaning of the date of adoption or modification? If it is a society, or a Section 25 company, or a landed company that controls 13 Section 8 company, I think it would be the date of adoption of the resolution by the general body for amendment to the memorandum. If it's a trust, what is the date? Is it the date of trustee resolution or the date of the court order which amends the trustee? And I would feel that the modification really takes effect from the date of the court order, and that's the correct date. But I think it's always better that once the trustees have passed the resolution and are making, before making an application, I think it's advisable that one seeks the approval of the commissioner. So that is one aspect. Now the other thing is, I think it's the simplest way out is, what is the condition of registration? You take prior approval of the commissioner before you modify your office. I think that's one simple way to talk about this. Now, a question which arises, would this amendment hit past modification which are made? That's a question which has arisen, and I would feel that no, this would not apply so far as the past modifications are made, or so far which have been made. This would apply only with effect from modifications which are made on or after this amendment comes into effect, which is April 17. Now, of course, the difficulty which will be faced is that if you make a modification before the end of the year, you make an application for fresh registration in 30 days. But the registration application is not decided by the date of filing of return, which is there today, even for new trusts, etc. This problem is there. That problem is something which will continue to hit the child. The other, there are two amendments in so far as charitable is concerned. And one of them is, again, as Mr. Kishor mentioned, it's something which is extremely harsh on charitable trust. You know, last year an amendment had come saying that if a charitable trust wants accumulation under section 11.2, 11.2 is an accumulation for a period of up to 5 years, where you file a form number 10, etc. If you want that merit of that accumulation, then the charitable trust has to file its return of income in time. If it does not file the return of income in time, it will not get the benefit of accumulation under 11.2. Now this year, so therefore, last year in a sense they were testing the waters. This year they have gone the whole hall. And what they have said is that if the trust files return of income late, then it will not be entitled to exemption under 11.12. Now, there is no provision for reasonable cause at all. Now, how can you have such a provision? Now, there could be genuine reasons why, you know, the trust is not able to file its rate. There is no this for condonation of a delay in genuine cases. So that is the real problem, that it's unlike, you know, for penalty, which you have 273B, which says that if there is a reasonable cause, no penalty. Now, you know what happens is charitable trust, if I return one day late, you lose your exemption altogether. Now, this is something I think which is very harsh, and which I think certainly should be represented against. The next amendment, of course, it's in relation to capital gains, but which has to do with charitable trust, is that you have this concept, as I said, this accredited income, where you pay tax on the fair market value of the assets, because trust is deemed to have diluted itself to non-charitable purposes. Now there, what happened is, you are paying tax on the fair market value, but subsequently when you sell that asset, what is the cost? The cost will remain the original cost, that was the anomaly which remained. Now that anomaly has been amended, has been rectified by amending the law, section 49 has been amended, to say that whatever is the fair market value of the asset taken for the purpose of accredited income, that would be the cost for the subsequent combination of capital gains will be actually transferred here. And the last amendment related to charitable trust is in section 80G, whereby, you know, 80G deduction was not available if you made a donation exceeding Rs 10,000 in cash. Now the amendment is that 10,000 rupees has come down to 2,000 rupees. The way the finance minister said it was that I am prohibiting donations to charitable trust exceeding 2,000 in cash. That's not a total prohibition. What will happen is if you make a donation exceeding 2,000 in cash, you will not get deduction at 80G. That's all. So, for instance, if you make a donation to a religious trust, there is no prohibition, there is nothing. So, you are not claiming 80G in any case. So, that's the, so far as the charitable trust is concerned. Political parties, I think I will skip given the fact that, of course, the only wholesome part which is I like about the political parties is that just as charitable trust, even if a political party files a return of income late, then if it does, it will lose the benefit of exemption. Yeah. Hopefully, because of political pressure, this will be this, you know, there will be some amendment in this so the political parties are concerned. So charitable trust may also get some benefit because of that. So that's the only hope that one has. And you have concept of electoral bonds and donations, cash donations, so those are the issues which are there. Coming to the next exemption, and which is in relation to income from house property, where there we had when a builder has completed construction of a building, he has unsold flats. Those flats are scheme, he is the owner of those flats. The question is the annual value of those flats liable to income tax? As you know, annual value is something which arises out of ownership of a property, and therefore there had been a dispute between the courts. You had the Gujarat High Court in the case of Neha Builders in 2007 CTR 231 taking a view that no, the annual value is not charitable to tax in such cases. But the Delhi and Bombay High Courts had taken a contrary view in answer to Hoskins case, Delhi High Court, and in Sani and Doshi Enterprises, Bombay High Court. They had taken a view that no, the annual value is charitable to tax in the hands of the builder, of the developer in such a case. And now, therefore, I'm told that the Kishor committee had, this was taken up the Kishor committee. The Kishor committee recommended that yes, this is something which is not called for really. You know, should not be, because really, see the exemption. If you look at the exemption which is there, is if the property is occupied for the purpose of business. Now, so far as the flats are concerned, which are stock in trade, they are not occupied for the purpose of business. They held for the purpose of business, but not occupied for the purpose of business. And therefore, that was the difficulty. But the Kishor Company Board had recommended that, you know, this is something which is unjust, therefore, there should be a benefit given. And look at what the benefit which is given. As you know, today, you have a large amount of unsold properties all over India, you know, and particularly in metro cities, etc. So, what they say is, annual value should be taken in the middle for a period of 1 year from the end of financial year, which certificate of completion of property is obtained. So, the only good part about it is they have referred to the completion certificate, not the occupancy certificate. So what would happen is, I think most builders would probably delay obtaining the completion certificate for some small thing, etc. On the basis of occupancy certificate, you can sell the property and then obtain the completion certificate. So that's something which is really possible. Now, this would apply, you know, in a sense, because the property has been completed, say, was 2 years back. That property also would be liable to tax, etc. That sort of something which would this. And of course, the issue really is this, that what happened over the past? I cannot say that because of the fact that, you know, the kind of important change is that the annual value to be taken and will has come only now. That means annual value was always taxable. That is the view which the department trying to take. And I think there could be litigation on that, but the better view is that no, it was perhaps, may not have been liable. But the other issue, of course, here is what if the flats are actually let out by the builder and he receives some rent? And there, I think, you know, there does seem to be a view which is possible that the actual rent received, because the annual value is either the amount of the notional rental value or the actual rent received. So, whichever is higher. So, therefore, the question here is possibly, you know, when the annual value should be taken as bill, maybe the builder could argue in the other way around, saying that this is, you know, not to be taxed. But the question then is, would this then be business income, taxable as business income? Possibly yes. So, that's where the difficulty would certainly arise. The other large amendment so far as house property is concerned is, you know, today for one house, the interest deduction is limited to 2 lakh rupees. For any other house whose annual value is chargeable to tax, there is no limit on the interest deduction. So you could have a large loss under the head income of house property, which you can offset against your other income. Now, there is an amendment which says that the total loss under the head income from house property. So what you have to do is take all the house properties put together, work out what is the income, what is the loss, and what is the, if the net figure is a loss. That loss, which is eligible for set off, cannot exceed 2 lakh rupees against other heads of income. It will be carried forward for set off over the next 8 years under the rule of 1671B. So, within 8 years, if you do not, if you cannot adjust it, it lapses. Now, what happens here is that what you look at is net position of loss under the overall head of income. So, source wise set off is possible. So, you might have one property which is let off and your earnings, say, was the value of which is okay, of 70 lakhs, you have a loss of say 50 lakhs. So that is possible. So with the net income of 80 lakhs, so that is possible within the same head, different sources or different properties. That is something which is possible. Now, of course, here one interesting aspect is that can I choose to say that this loss, so far as this loss is concerned, in a subsequent year I will first adjust this loss and then I will claim that my interest, etc. In the context of speculation loss, there is a CBDT circular which has, for which you will first set off the brought forward speculation loss and then the current year can be, you know, carried forward, etc. But in this case, I don't think that is something which is possible. I think clearly, therefore, this would result in a loss which will lapse altogether. Then coming to capital gains, I think they're quite a show metrics and we are running on a short of time. So far as the immovable property is concerned, which is land or building or both, the period of holding is reduced from 36 months to 24 months. Today you already have 24 months for shares which are other than listed shares. So now you will also have, so far as immovable property is concerned. This would not apply to, I think, in the context of 50C, because the language used in 50C is similar, which says immovable property being land or building or both. So therefore, in the context, so there the tribunals have taken a view that this would not apply to leasehold land, it would not apply to tenancy rights, it would not apply to a house which is under construction, because that is not a ready property. So in that sense, possibly this would again, this question would again come up here, and these may not get the benefit. So if it is a house under construction, there possibly a period of 36 months is something you want out of abundant precaution. I think one should take the view that it would be 36 months. But if it, so therefore it would be only for a completed property that is period of 24 months. Secondly, unfortunately this controversy about whether the date of booking or the date of certain agreement or the date of registration or the date of possession, which is the date of acquisition of a house and when you acquire a house under construction, that is something which has not been unfortunately addressed by this amendment. And therefore you would still have a controversy to continue. You had a conjoint Karia High Court taking the view that is the date of agreement, Bombay High Court taking contrary view that it would be the date of possession effectively. But that controversy would still be something to continue. The second thing is, so far as 54-54X is concerned, when you have claimed an exemption by buying a new house under 54-54X, then you still have to hold that house for a period of 3 years. So there it's not a question of whether long term or short term. This amendment is only for whether it is long term or short term for that purpose. So for 54-54F, when you claim an exemption, you still have to hold it for a period of 3 years. The next amendment in capital gains is so far as conversion of preference shares into equity shares is concerned. You had earlier a decision of the Andhra Pradesh High Court in the case of Nizam's second subject family trust in 102 ITR 248, where the Andhra Pradesh High Court had taken the view that conversion of a preference share into an equity share amounts to a transfer. After that, the law had been amended. You had 55(2)(AA), which was introduced, which clause 5 of that provides that where one type, in case of 55(2)(AA) deals with, so far as 55(2)(B), sorry, 5, it deals with the cost of an asset, and they said that whereas conversion of shares, one type of share of one company into another type of shares, then the cost of the previous shares is to be taken as the cost. Now, that amendment had come in after this decision. We had, of course, a Bombay High Court decision in the case of Santosh Chavade in 24 ITR 287, where the Bombay High Court has said under the scheme of arrangement of company, certain equity shares were converted into preference shares, and they said that that is the transfer because the rights of equity shares are quite different from the rights under preference shares. So they're quite different rights, so they're different assets, and that would amount to a transfer. But as I said, 52(b)(5) is something which had not been argued in that case, as well as it was not had been subsequent to the under the High Court decision. So therefore, now what we have, there was also an old CBDT letter of 12 May 1964, which has said that there is no transfer of conversion of preference shares into equity shares. So there was a significant amount of uncertainty on this. Therefore, now they have specifically brought in an amendment saying that conversion of preference shares into equity shares will not be an exempt transfer under Section 47, Clause (2)(b). And the corresponding amendments that the holding period will also of the equity shares will include the holding period of preference shares. So that amendment is there in 42A. And cost of acquisition of the equity shares will be the cost of acquisition of preference shares. There also you have 49. 2AE which is inserted for that. Now, earlier period of course I said that that is something which possibly there could still be in litigation. Because there is only exemption for conversion of bonds to debentures or deposit into shares or debentures. That will be. Coming to the change of the base year for indexation, as you know, it's from 1st April 81, which has been there for almost now 20 years. They've changed it to 1st April 2001. So you will get indexation also from 1st April 2001. The new index will obviously be notified that index will start from 2001 to 2002. And because of the fact that they're taking the fair market value as on 1st April 2001, so therefore only cost of improvement after 1st April 2001 will be considered, and not cost of improvement of the earlier period. So this is certainly an advantage because, you know, one thing you have to understand that the cost inflation index which is announced by the government, it neutralizes only 75% of the consumer price inflation. So therefore, now what is happening is from 81 to 2001, 100% of the inflation is really being neutralized. And therefore, you know, it's definitely something which will be useful. 54 EC bonds, there is a power taken to notify more bonds for category exemption, not just NHAI and REC, because you know these bonds are not. Then so far as the rate of capital gains tax on transfer of unlisted shares by non-listed is concerned, you know that you had this from SSBD 1314, you had an amendment which said that capital gains on transfer of unlisted securities by non-listed would be taxable at a concessional rate of 10%. So the object was to bring the, in the finance minister's speech, he said the object is to bring this of non-resident on par with FIIs, which pays this 10%. There was a doubt whether unlisted shares would be covered because, as you know, there are a series of decisions of the Bombay High Court and some Supreme Court decisions which have taken the view that so far as unlisted shares are concerned, they are not securities because they are not freely marketable. There was an amendment made last year with the SSBD 17-18 saying that unlisted, so far as shares of companies in the public are not substantially interested, will also qualify for this 10% benefit. Now, this is one retrospective amendment which is really a good amendment. What they have done is, they said that they have made this amendment applicable with effect from SSBD 15-14. So instead of from SSBD 17-18, it will apply for SSBD 13-14. So, non-resident which has sold these shares of a private company, with effect from SSBD 13-14, we get the benefit of the 10% concession rate. Coming to the business income, first category is cash payments. You know, under 48(3), you had this, if you make payments in cash, say 20,000 rupees, you had the discounts, which is 30% of that, which is there. Now, there the reference was to account pay check or account pay bank draft. Otherwise, there's an account pay check or account pay bank draft. An amendment is now made to say that electronic or electronic clearing system through a bank account. So that is also permitted now. So other than these three modes, if you make a payment, then it will be discounted. That's the first amendment. The second amendment is that instead of 20,000 rupees, the limit is brought down to 10,000 rupees. And you know, the government has said very much, you know, that we want to ensure that the cash transactions are reduced and all that. So if today you pay salary to an employee exceeding 10,000 rupees. Now there is of course a situation where the employee on repetition etc. There are some exceptions which are there in Rule 60D. But otherwise, if you normal in the normal course you pay salary exceeding 10,000 to an employee, that will fall for disallowance. Or you know any expense exceeding 10,000 rupees will fall for disallowance. There is specific exemption for debit card and credit card payments in Rule 60D. So you know, because you would think otherwise credit card and debit card are not technically covered, but there is specific. But mobile wallet should not be counted. So if you make a payment by your mobile wallet, you know, your Paytm or etc. So that was something which is not still not covered. And the second thing is, you know, they will use electronic clearing system through a bank account. Now you have this new concept of payment banks which are coming in. And payment banks, for instance, if you give a payment to the payment bank and a payment bank does a bank transfer, it's not through a bank account that it's done. Now would that qualify? That's the question mark which would still remain, and that's the second amendment here in this cash payments is that the definition of actual cost under 43(1) is being amended to say that if you make payment for purchase of an asset, acquisition of an asset, where involving payments or aggregate payments in a day exceeding 10,000 by modes other than these three, that account, paycheck, bank draft, or electronic transfer, you exclude that much by amount from the actual cost. So whatever you have paid by cash, effectively, you will exclude it from the actual cost. So this will impact your depreciation, it will impact your reduction under Section 35 if you can in fact this is an expenditure. Now, this applies to payments which are made on or after 1st April 2000. This will apply to payments made after 1st April 2007. What if you have, say, purchased the asset in the month, in the earlier month, and payment is made in subsequent month? Unlike in the 40SV, where you have 40SVA, which says that, you know, if payment is made in subsequent year, what will happen, etc. Here, there is no such specific provision which is there. So that's something which, and possibly, if, since that was made, that was a purchase prior to the acquisition, possibly one be able to argue that this will not get affected. And then, what about a situation where a bank, you see, typically when you buy, say, a plant, certain machinery, the bank directly makes a disbursement to the supplier. Now, what about that position? What would be the position over there? It's something which, again, is a question mark, I think. And the very important thing here is 6DD exemptions would not apply over here. There is no provision for a notification of situations under which you can make, you know, extended in circumstances. So, for instance, I think we have many good friends of ours who go to attend international conferences and they purchase books over there by using their credit cards. Now that, I don't know whether they will be able to claim that as a, you know, the books is amount to purchase of capital asset. So whether they will get the benefit of this is a question mark. So that's something which I think which will be a question which will arise. Similarly, 35AD, there is a thing that where you have made an expenditure, you know, 35AD, as you know, is your invest capital in the investment being deduction for certain specified businesses. So where you get the deduction of the capital expenditure which you have incurred. Now there again, if you make the payment exceed 10,000 rupees, otherwise then by account pay, bank draft or by electronic system transfer, then that will be disallowed. That will not be considered for the purpose of deduction. Then, 43B so far did not cover interest from corporate on borrowing from cooperative banks. Other than those cooperative banks which are scheduled banks, now all cooperative banks will be covered other than privately acted credit society and privately acted cooperative banks which are rural development bank. Then on the interest on NPAs of cooperative banks, you know, they were also, again, that was not, you had 43D section which says that it will at the time of credit to the profit and loss account, but at the time of receipt of the amount which was earlier, the interest would be taxable. Because as you know, interest on NPAs is something which you don't accrue from time to time. You accrue for it only when you receive it. So therefore, they said that now the we had the Bombay High Court in the case of Delhi and the Sarkari Bank Limited, a decision of January 2015, which said that corporate bank also are eligible for the benefit. And that is now we come about to this amendment which is made in Section 43B. So far, maintenance of books or accounts is concerned, Section 44AA, where the limits for you know, business and professions other than professions specified in subsection 1 is increased from 1,20,000 to 2,50,000 income limit, and the turnover limit is increased from 10 lakhs to 25 lakhs. Now, what is important to note is that the increased amount is only for individual and HFs, for whether it's of new business or existing business, but it's only individual and HF. The old limits continue to apply for other entities, for other types of entities. And also, but you have to remember that those entities may be governed by laws governing those entities. For instance, LLP Act may require books for accounts to be maintained, etc. So in respect of the so therefore that would still apply. Then tax audit for OEB, there was the amendment which had come in last year, whereby the limit was enhanced to 2 crore. But the tax audit limit what had not got enhanced. For presumptive taxation under 44AD, the limit had got enhanced to 2 crore. But tax audit limit remained at 1 crore, so the CBD had clarified earlier. Now that clarification had been brought about through effect had been given to that through the amendment to 44AD to say that where the income is being offered to tax by under the provision of 44AD at the specified rates, then in that situation, the limit of 2 crore will apply and not the limit of 1 crore. Then presumptive tax, as you know, again in December there was this clarification which was given by the CBDT that for the percentage of 6%, where in case of total turnover processes received by account, paycheck or bank draft, or electronic payment system to the bank account, if it is received during the previous year or on or before the due date under section 139(1). That's the amendment. Now they brought it into an amendment saying that if you have received this before during the same year or before the due date under 139(1), then you will get the benefit of the 6%. But if the amount is outstanding on the date of return, obviously that would be taxable at 8% as in case of other term loan. But one of the important things here is what you remember is the 6% or 8% is not something which is mandatory. If your actual income is higher, then you can't say that no, I will pay tax only on 6% or only on 8%. That is something you need to keep in mind. So particularly if you want to take the benefit of that higher income, and that's one of the things which I think I'm running out of time. So what I will do is maybe on this TDS on rent and the 194 IB, I think that's something which I will just touch upon. So this, as mentioned, is not, it's applicable to an individual and HUF who is not subject to audit under Section 44AB. Now, a person, an individual and HUF who is liable to audit under 44AB is governed by Section 194I. So if you pay rent exceeding 1,80,000, there is a TDS at 10% there. Now here, so those who are not subject to tax audit are those individuals and HUFs. If they pay rent exceeding 50,000 per month or part thereof, TDS has to be deducted at 5%. Now this TDS is deductible at the time of credit of the last month's rent or payment thereof, whichever is earlier. Now if Section 206AA is applicable, which is that person does not have a PAN or the PAN is incorrect, and then 20% rate applies, the tax to be deducted shall not exceed the last month's rent. That is the basic rule. Now this applies to all properties. So it's not just a residential house or any other. Of course, business properties, whether it's, if you're liable to tax or it's a different thing, but if you're not liable to tax or it, then even business property. But the part of, the worst part of this is, say for instance, you pay 75,000 rupees for a function, say for a marriage function, you book a marriage hall, or a ground you book for a marriage function. Now there on that also TDS would apply, this 5% would apply. So carrying on business by payer is not an essential thing. The only saving grace is that no TAN is required, no TDS return is required to be filed. It's a one-time, probably a one-time online payment, just like we have on the 192i. So that's the way in which you have to do this. So far as call center payments are concerned, call center payment under 194g, there is an amendment saying that TDS at 2% applies if the cases of payments made to a payee who is engaged only in the business of a call center. Now, firstly, the question really arises, is payment to call center in the nature of fees for professional or fees for technical services or is it professional services? So that's the first question which arises really. Because I would think that these are really payments from business of business. One to C would apply, not one to J in any case. And secondly, when I'm making the payment, how do I determine whether he's engaged solely in the business of call center or not? And what happens is, I make a payment at a point of time and he's engaged solely in the business of call center. Subsequently, he starts some other business also towards the end of the year. What happens? Now, therefore, these are the difficulties on which I'm sure there would be some amount of litigation, etc., which would come in. Time limits for completion of assessments, etc., those are those amendments have come in. 132, of course, that reason to believe or reason to suspect that non-disclosure to any person or the ITT. Of course, high courts, obviously they cannot stop the high court from asking for it, but this is something which will create quite a few difficulties. There's a provision for, in case of search, provision attachment during the course of search or within the period of 60 days from the last warrant, execution of the last warrant, or the last authorization. And also provision now for that attachment can be valid for a period of up to 6 months. There is also provision for now reference to a valuation officer during the course of search or within this period of 60 days. So that is something which would again create a large amount of difficulties. Kishor did refer to this aspect about scope of survey for charity, extended down to a place where charitable activity is carried on. Now, I think this is something this will give rise to some difficulties because particularly large number of charities, you know, the home address of the trustee is given in many cases. Now, what would happen is, as a registered officer, now, can one say that this is a place where charitable activities carried on? You know, probably the department will say yes, that you have this charitable activity carried on because of the fact that it's a registered address. But I think there is a view possible that yes, that's not a place where it would be the place where actual charitable activities carried on, not just the registered address, where particularly where the office is not functioning as the address. You have administrative office as a different place. You have this fees for delayed returns which have now come in, it's just like your 234E. You have to pay this fee before you file the return and under 148. So probably you will not be able to upload the return without paying this fee for the delayed return. And then lastly, the amendment which was referred to about the penalty, I think the application is, so far as penalty is concerned, in case of a certificate issued by a chartered accountant or a merchant banker where incorrect information has been furnished. Now, there I think it's the power of levy penalty is with the assessing officer or the commissioner appeals, and the penalty can be up to 10,000 rupees. There is a provision, of course, for reasonable cause under section 273B. There is also an appeal which would lie against this because all penalties levied under chapter 21 would be appealed against to the commissioner appeals. Now, if the commissioner appeals itself levying the penalty, I think it's something which, again, there the question is whether appeal to tribunal is something which one might see. But this, I think, is something which the question is really is this, that today, you know, there could be genuine mistakes. And therefore, assessing officers, you know, could take extremely this and so far as levy of penalty is concerned. But what about mistakes by assessing officers? What about the accountability there? That is something which I think one still does not see. This is all a one-way traffic. That today everybody else is being made accountable. Today you have defective return formats now in the system. Today a charitable return format is not in accordance with the law. Now who is responsible for that? Thousands of SSCs have to try and figure out a way to file their returns. So you have certain things where you are not able to file your return in the correct manner. You have to find a way to enter that information. Now, you know, so these are problems. Now, who is responsible for that? Is there no accountability? Now, that is something I think, I don't know whether one will ever see the day where that sort of accountability will come in. Where such, you have a classic case where, for instance, your OM guidelines are finalized only towards the end of the year. After 9 months are over, and you say that it will apply for the whole year. You have a provision for saying that how the if a company is regarded as having OM in India, how would it apply, etc. Those rules have not yet, have not yet been notified. So I really don't know, is accountability only a one-way traffic? I think it's something which one will have to really ask the government, I think, whether that's the, so therefore really in that sense there's been no change in the attitude from that perspective. Well, I think, I'm sorry, I overshot my time. Thank you all of you for very patient.
First, with the break for the official, and we'll try to